You know, this is like a great movie. Many of you have seen it. I'm not sure that the music really is the best way to remind you. Let's remind you of the problem we were working on in the last video. How far did we get? We know what we're trying to test, which is the null hypothesis, and that is the same as testing whether the slope is zero. I hope with the past videos you're comfortable with the idea of testing the slope is zero tells you whether there's a relationship between those two, the null saying there is not. We've also seen that the test statistic has the same form as what we've seen with earlier tests. This equation should look familiar. If it doesn't, please contact me so that we can talk about how you need to sign up for this class next semester. And this test would be really easy if we had these two numbers here. The good news, the computer does it for you. And in the homework and in the exams, you'll see the output from regression done by a computer, and you don't actually have to do the calculation. This homework should be easier than what we've done before because the computer's doing all the hard work. This output that I'm showing you is a program called R, but I don't care if you're using Excel or Minitab or SAS or one of the other 100 programs out there, it's going to look similar as far as regression. Let's look at what's important here. This is telling me the formula it's using, some stuff with residuals. That's important, but we're going to talk about how to look at those residual plots later. We've totally avoided the question of how large a sample size do we need? How do we know if our assumptions are met? There is an easy way to tell that in this chapter. It's going to be for a future video. Here is the important part, and every computer program does this little table right here. What do we have? We have estimates here. Those are our statistics. And we have the standard error, all that square root of squaring and whatever else, it's done for you. Here we actually have t values and p values. I'll get to that in just a second. This is for the intercept. Now, the y-intercept isn't actually that important to us because it doesn't talk about the relationship between x and y. And we've already had a couple of videos that talked about this. So I hope you're okay with the fact that we don't need this intercept unless we were doing a prediction. And there would be our intercept for the prediction. I'll talk about that later. For the slope, here is our estimate, 0.3105. That's the slope we got. Remember, the null hypothesis said we were going to get zero. Well, we didn't exactly get zero. We got 0.3105. Okay, well, what does that mean? It means the slope we got wasn't zero, it's 0.3105. And that's the number that goes right here in our equation. So we're basically halfway done calculating this. Now all we need is the second number if we know where to look, which is the second row of this table, right under that first column for the estimate. The second column has that standard error, which is exactly the number I need right here. My degrees of freedom are n minus 2 with n of 100. That means 98 degrees of freedom. And there's all the hard pieces. All the math was done by the computer. Getting both of these numbers came right off that output. So I'll bet that I can finish out the rest of this hypothesis with 1 minute. Time me. I want to test if runtime is affected by water amount. The null hypothesis would say not so much. The alternative says yes, there is a difference. The slope being zero for the null, slope not being zero for the alternative. I'm going to use an alpha of 0.05 because while some of you don't care, some of you are actually timing me and now I'm stressed. Here for the t-score is going to be 0.3105 divided by 0.4065, which comes out to be about 0.764. Did you notice I cheated? It's actually right there. I didn't calculate anything. It tells me in the output what that t-score actually is. And now to find my p-value, I am going to pull up my applet. If I can center it, how much time do I have left? Not nearly enough. I need a t-score. Degrees of freedom is 98. And my t-score was 0.764. Now this is a two-tailed test. So I want that side, which is 0.22335, and I'm going to double it, which I can do that in my head. I can double it and get 0.447, which is a large p-value. Large p-value means fail to reject, and so we would conclude that we can't show drinking water affects how long your runtime is. Notice we did get a positive slope here, so that it looked like drinking more water made you run faster. It wasn't enough of a slope to say we can prove that drinking water really has an effect. That's because if the slope truly was zero, you could get that kind of a slope, like what we saw out of our data, with high probability, 44%, this being a two-tailed test.
Okay, well, I didn't make it within 60 seconds, but there is one thing I need to emphasize. If you use the p-value off the computer output, it is a doubled p-value. By default, computers do that, all programs, and it's actually hard to tell it not to do that. So anytime in the homework or on exams that you see a p-value for regression, just know that was a two-tailed p-value. It was doubled.